A very good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Hindi News Analysis brought to you by Shankar AS Academy for the date 5th of October 2021. Let us take a moment to congratulate all 360 plus selections from our academy. I think that is a moment of inspiration for every one of us. So with that, let's move on to the discussion for today. See, we have chosen about 8 articles for discussion. See, the last article is about the Mekadatu project. We are not going to discuss in detail because that was already discussed on August 20th, which is very recent. So we'll be discussing 7 topics in detail. The first topic will be about the Forest Act. See, the government is proposing about a couple of changes in the Forest Conservation Act. And we will be talking about that. And we will also be talking about the environmental ethical issues involved in this proposed change. So that will be a brief discussion. And nextly, we will be talking about the Nobel Prize that has been given away for physiology or medicine. So why has it been given and what is the discovery lying behind it? So that will be the discussion in the second part of our discussion today. And nextly, we will be talking about Exercise Milan. See, this is a naval exercise and it is a biennial exercise that has been happening, but didn't happen last year because of the COVID. And the government has proposed that it shall happen in 2022 of Feb. So we'll be discussing briefly about it. It's a prelims oriented topic. And next we'll be talking about drone based vaccine delivery. And it has happened in Northeast for the first time in India. So drones is an important topic right now because it has come into vogue very recently and it has been finding application, especially in the pandemic situation. So we can be using that as a case study also. So based on that, we'll shape the discussion that way. And apart from that, we'll be talking about smog towers. There has been an editorial article on smog towers. We'll see how they function, how effective are they really effective, and also about the way forward to tackle the air pollution. And next, we'll be talking about an art and culture topic. We'll be talking about a wind instrument called Nadaswaram. And this Nadaswaram occupies a very important space in the Carnatic music, that is the music of South India. So we'll be talking about that. And lastly, we'll also be talking about 2 practice preliminary questions. And with that, we'll end the discussion for today. Now look at this news article. See, this news article talks about the proposed amendments to the existing Forest Conservation Act of 1980. See, this piece of amendment or this piece of change can be interpreted for your ethics answers as well. And apart from that, it is also important for the GS paper too. So pay attention. By the end of this segment, I'll also tell you how to utilize this particular discussion for your main exam. Okay, so the central government is of the opinion that this law is outdated. That is, the Forest Conservation Act is outdated. So an amendment is proposed to adjust the Forest Conservation Act to the present circumstances, focusing on accelerating the integration of the conservation and development. So first understand that Forest Conservation Act was enacted with the objective of providing a higher level of protection to the forest. So as the name goes, right, Forest Conservation Act. And currently the Forest Conservation Act is applicable to all the government forest lands and the areas recorded as the forest in any government record. And the Forest Conservation Act brought 2 major reforms when it was actually enacted. First is that it made the prior approval of the central government necessary for 2 issues. One is the de-reservation of the already reserved forest. Okay, so we know that reserved forests enjoy higher levels of protection. So when you de-reserve a reserved forest, the levels of protection goes down. So in order to make that stronger, the de-reservation of the reserved forest was brought under the central government. Second, for diverting the use of forest land for non-forest purposes. So the central government approval is needed for this as well. So you may ask, what is a non-forest purpose? So non-forest purpose means breaking up or clearing any forest land for 1. the cultivation of tea, coffee, spices, rubber, palm, oil-bearing plants, horticultural crops, or medicinal plants. Basically, converting the forest into a plantation or a commercial area is non-forest purpose. And the second criteria of non-forest purpose is any purpose other than reafforestation, right? So we have two criteria that determine the non-forest purposes. One is conversion into a commercial area. And second is any purpose other than reafforestation. That does not include planting of trees as a forest. So these two purposes, if at all, if it happens, the central government approval is needed. Okay, now note that the NFP, that is non-forest purposes, does not include any work that is relevant to conservation or development and management of forest and wildlife. Correct? For example, establishment of a checkpost is not a non-forest purpose. Or for that matter, say you are laying a pipeline to take water from the forest, then that is also not a non-forest purpose. Or even construction of dam is not a non-forest purpose. Now, second, the Forest Conservation Act provides for the constitution of an advisory committee for advising the central government in granting the approval. So, because of this, it is mandatory for the state governments, or for that matter, a union territory administration, to get prior approval of the central government before making an order for diversion, de-reservation, or even assignment of lease of any forest land. So, this is all about the Forest Conservation Act in the raw form. Now, because the center believes that this particular act is outdated, it has proposed two major amendments. First is the amendment to the definition of non-forest purposes. So, as we already saw, the definition provides which is to be considered as NFP and which is not to be considered as NFP. So, in this manner, it is proposed to keep certain activities outside the definition of NFP. So, this includes establishment of zoos, safaris, establishment of forest trading infrastructures. And apparently, the government considers these activities are relevant to conservation of forest and wildlife. We really don't know how these activities are relevant to the conservation of wildlife. But anyways, what we can see is the establishment of zoos and safaris is a measure of central government's income. So this is going to be a contentious amendment. And I'll give you a heads up here. A lot of people are going to write a lot of editorials on this. So just be prepared. So have this basic understanding on this particular amendment that is proposed. Second, it proposes to exempt certain projects from getting approval. So this includes strategic and security projects of national importance. Fair enough. So this is proposed so that states can permit non-forest use of forest land for implementation of such projects that are required to be completed in a given time frame. See, it is because currently such projects require land, and these lands come under the ambit of non-forestry use of forest. So the central government's approval is needed, which delays the execution of the projects. So this could be seen in the case of development of infrastructure along with the international border areas. So the second amendment is quite fair enough because it involves the question of security in the forest. And we know, especially in the Northeast and all, the forests are being misused by the extremist elements to hide from the security agencies. So they want to strengthen the infrastructure in this particular area so that they can strengthen the security. See, like I said, I'll tell you how to use this information in your ethics answer. The second part, that is the question of security versus infrastructure, or for that matter, even the First Amendment, which seeks to establish zoos and safaris and forest, which is income yielding. See, here, note that India, after the COVID and all, is in need of a lot of money to uplift the poor, to enforce certain welfare schemes. So, India is in need of a lot of money, and government is in search of avenues for revenue. So, in that justification, we can say that the First Amendment that seeks to establish zoos and safaris is fair enough. But on the other hand, we can also see that under the name of revenue, we are also infringing on the forest areas, infringing on the greeneries, especially in the context of climate change. So we can see that this is a classic debate between development versus environment. Okay, so if at all you face any question on ethics on development versus environment, you can actually quote this particular proposed amendment in your paper so that your answer will have more value. Now, coming to the second amendment, this talks about the question of security versus environment. So, development versus environment is one major area that is going into a debate, whereas security and environment is another debate that actually, you know, does not have an answer. Especially in the border areas, the security takes precedence always compared to the environment. So many experts will say the security should take precedence, and many experts will say the environment should take precedence. But this is a never-ending debate that is a potential question in your ethics answer as well. So when you're framing an ethics answer, you can use these two proposed amendments in your answers as well. So basically, this is a topic of environmental ethics. And apart from that, it is also important for your paper too. So keep in mind, with that, let's move on to the next segment of today's discussion. See, this is already October and Nobel Prize announcements are being made. And recently, the Nobel Prize announcement for physiology has been made for the year 2021. So this award has been jointly given to two United States scientists. One is David Julius and the next is Adam Patapoutian. So first, let us see what this Nobel Prize has been awarded for. Basically, they both have discovered regarding the receptors of temperature and touch. So first, let us understand what are these receptors and how are they perceived and everything. First, let us go through some basics before we actually get into their discovery. Okay, our body has certain things called somatoreceptors. Okay, see, somato means body. Okay, so receptors are something that actually receives the external changes, be it heat, be it cold. Okay, so let us go with a familiar example. Say, for example, take tongue. Okay, see, you might have read in NCERT that entire tongue does not perceive the same set of tastes, right? Say, for example, the posterior part of the tongue will be perceiving bitterness, and the lateral part of the tongue will actually perceive salt taste. So likewise, different sides of the tongue perceives different kinds of taste. It means different receptors are present at different areas of the tongue. See, what are these receptors? See, some receptors will be able to recognize salty taste. Some receptors will be able to recognize bitter taste, and some receptors will be able to recognize sweet taste. How does it happen? So all the skin area, or for that matter mucus area, will have underlying neurons, okay, or the nerve endings. So neurons are nothing but neural cells, and these cells are long, just like this. So they are this long and they have like the trail like structure, and at the end they open onto the skin. So when something impacts this neuron, so some kind of electrical signal picks up, and this travels through the neuron, and one neuron transmits it to another neuron, and this transmission actually happens at the nerve endings, and these nerve endings have something called neural transmitters. So these electrical signals, they are picked up by neurons and they go on to the brain. And there they are perceived either as salt or sweet or bitter. So based on the receptors and the reception, the brain perceives what is the taste. Okay, so this is how the basic somatoreceptors work. Now coming back to this article, see, our skin also has certain receptors. Some receptors will be receptive to cold. Some receptors will be receptive to warm temperatures. So some receptors will be able to detect some kind of sensation. And this is exactly why the Nobel Prize has been awarded. Pay attention, we'll discuss it further. So in case of somatic senses, that is bodily sensations, the receptors detect and convert the physical properties of various stimuli, such as mechanical and thermal properties, into electrical signals. Just the way the taste is getting converted, right? So then these signals are conveyed to the central nervous system, right? And the scientists who have won the Nobel Prize have discovered that these thermal and the mechanical receptors. See, thermal means something that can detect hot or cold. And mechanical means that can detect the pressure on the skin or the body. So they have discovered these kind of receptors. See, here David Julius wanted to have fundamental insights into the mechanism of pain. So what he did was he studied something called capsaicin. Sounds familiar to you all? See, capsicum, yeah? So capsaicin is a chemical compound that is actually found in chili peppers, right? Basically chilies. And the capsaicin causes the burning sensation when we come in contact with the chilies, right? Everyone will not enjoy the sensation, the burning sensation. So the scientist David Julius studied how it causes this burning sensation. See, this is all the overview, right? How the receptor is impacted and how is it transmitted and how is it received in the brain and how is it perceived. This is all overview, but all these are backed by genes. See, already in many of our discussions, we know that genes are the basic genetic material that determines our characters. Yeah? So, say one gene is codes for brown eyes, then the individual will have brown eyes. Say one gene codes for an individual to be tall, then the individual will be tall. And say similarly, one gene codes for a person to perceive heat or touch, then the person will be able to understand what is heat, what is touch, and what is pressure. Basically, David Julius had discovered which is the gene that actually causes a person to understand what is heat, what is cold, and what is touch, right? So he ultimately found that the capsaicin receptor called as TRPV1 was responsible for someone to perceive the burning sensation. So understand this, say the gene TRPV1 says that the individual will be able to perceive heat. Then the individual will be able to perceive heat. Say if the TRPV1 is absent, then the individual will not be able to sense the heat. So this is the important discovery. So basically TRPV1 is responsible for someone to perceive the burning sensation caused by capsaicin. Okay, and after this discovery, he further investigated the protein's ability to respond to heat. And this led to the discovery that actually TRPV1 is a heat sensing receptor. And it is activated at temperatures which are perceived as painful. So first he understood that TRPV1 was responsible for the detection of capsaicin. And next he understood that it was the one that was responsible for someone to realize heat. And it is activated at temperatures which are perceived as painful. So if the temperature is really hot, then we actually do not perceive it as heat. We actually perceive it as pain, right? And that is exactly this discovery means. And after the discovery of TRPV1, David Julius and Adam Patapoutian independently made another important advance. So what are these two names? Initially we saw, right, the Nobel Prize is shared between these two individuals. So they discovered another gene. This another gene is TRPM8. I repeat, TRPM8. This is a cold sensitive receptor. See, we saw TRPV1 is heat sensitive receptor. This TRPM8 is a cold sensitive receptor. That is when someone or something that is cold touches you, you will be able to say that this is cold. The temperature of this particular object is very low. So that is what is called as cold sensitive receptor. Now, after this, several additional TRP receptors were subsequently identified. And overall, TRPV1 led to the molecular understanding of the thermosensation. So that is the essence. So what is thermosensation? Thermo means temperature. So we were able to perceive the temperature. That is the understanding that we actually got. And apart from that, additionally, Adam discovered something called piezo channels. Just remember, piezo channels is ion channels. Adam found that these ion channels are activated by mechanical force. What is mechanical force? Say someone punches you, or say someone is holding you tight. So these are mechanical forces. And when this acts upon your skin, what happens is that the piezo channels are activated. So here there are two channels, piezo 1 and piezo 2. And they were found to be directly activated by the exertion of pressure on the cell membranes. So like I said, here are the skin cells, right? So when the mechanical force acts, these skin cells are activated only with the cell membranes. And particularly piezo 2's discovery led to many breakthrough discoveries subsequently. And especially piezo 2 was very relevant for the sense of touch. And together piezo 1 and piezo 2 also regulated many important physiological processes like pressure, like respiration, like bladder control and everything. So in short, these discoveries allowed us to understand how heat, cold and mechanical force can initiate the electrical impulses that allow us to perceive and adapt to the world. So in this discussion, we saw about somatosensations. What are somatosensations? What are receptors? We saw what are neurons, how they function, what are neurotransmitters, and we also saw about the discovery that earned them the Nobel Prize. Okay, and how the genes form the basis of any trait for an individual. So this is all that we saw today. So this is very important from the science and tech perspective. Okay, and most of the discussion that we had today, our static part, which is covered in NCERT. So I think that would have been a very good revision for you. So with that, let's move on to the next segment of today's discussion. Now look at this news article. In this article, we'll be talking about the exercise Milan. See, remember, exercise Milan is a naval exercise. Okay, that is the Navy's conduct. And this exercise Milan is considered to be one of the largest naval exercise across the globe itself. And previously, the naval exercise was scheduled in 2020, last year. And it was postponed due to the pandemic, thanks to Corona. And now the Navy has said that it is planning to conduct the naval exercise on 2022 February. Let us briefly know about this particular exercise. See, the exercise that is due in February 2022 will be the 11th edition of this particular exercise. See, this is a biennial exercise and it is a multilateral naval exercise. That is, many countries participate in this naval exercise. And it all started in 1995. And see, the Navy has held 10 editions of this exercise already. And generally, it is conducted in the Andaman and Nicobar Command, that is in Port Blair. Generally, it is conducted there. But right now, the Navy has shifted it to the Vizag, because Vizag port apparently is much more spacious and it has better facilities. And this exercise is quite strategic because the India has extended its invitation to about 46 countries. And apparently many have even accepted it. And what is more important is that all the Quad nations will be participating in this particular exercise that is planned for Feb 2020. And it generally comes under the Eastern Naval Command. And given that we have extended the invitation to 46 nations, we can say probably the 2022 edition will be the largest of the Milan exercise in the history, that is since 1995. So the exercise Milan is an important preliminary exam question. Okay, so keep the information in mind. With that, let's move on to the next article. See, the next article talks about the drone-based vaccine delivery. See, apparently, a drone has delivered vaccines in the difficult terrains of Northeast. And by road, apparently, it's 26 kilometers. And the drone had traveled about 15 kilometers on air and has delivered the vaccines in just 15 minutes. And this is the first time that a Make in India drone has been used in entire of South Asia to transport the COVID vaccines. So, and the entire exercise was done in the state of Manipur. Keep that in mind. See, why are we discussing this article? See, basically, drone is a potential area for paper 3 and as well as for essay paper. See, science-based essays are also being asked. So consider there is an essay that asks you to talk about the drones. In that case, you can actually talk about this as an application of drones, that is serving the medicines in difficult terrains. Because India has a diverse geography. right? We have islands, we have mountains, we have plateaus, we have rivers, we have riverine islands, right? So sometimes when the weather goes bad, or normally even in Northeast and all, the transportation can be extremely difficult. And the medicine access has been difficult in these areas. And here is where drone comes into picture, and it bridges the gap and delivers the medicines. So that is exactly what has been done here. So this particular incident can be quoted as a case study in your essay paper. And apart from that, even in your paper 3, if a question has been asked based on drones or their applications, you can of course quote the medicinal applications, not just delivery, but also collection of samples from the area. And if you think about it, see, drones, they don't generally have physical contact. And so the drones can actually be sent to those areas where there is a breakout of a disease, a localized breakout of a deadly disease, say consider like Nipah. In that case, a drone can be used to deliver the medicines to those areas as well as collect blood samples from those areas without risking infection. So this is the medical application of drones. So you can use this as your example in your paper 3 and essay paper. So with that, let's move on to the next article. Now look at this news article. This news article mentions about smog towers. See, recently, 2 new smog towers have been inaugurated in Delhi, if you know. Apart from that, we also have Bangalore and Chandigarh, which has smog towers. And this news article is written in this backdrop. Before getting into the context of the article, first, let us know what are these smog towers and how they work. And then we shall see about the points mentioned in the article one by one. Here is the syllabus relevant for this particular article. See, a smog tower is a structure designed as a large R medium scale air purifiers to reduce the air pollution, and usually by forcing the air through the filters. In simple words, a smog tower should actually be called anti-smog towers or smog-free towers. That is, they remove the smog from the air. And this tower is a large structure, and it performs the function of an air purifier or air cleaning, right? And that is why it is a large-scale air cleaning system or a large-scale air purifier. See, they are usually fitted with multiple layers of air filters. And these air filters clean the air pollutants as the air passes through them. So after cleaning, the tower releases clean air. And the smog tower is usually of downdraft type. Let us see what is it. That is, the polluted air enters from the top of the tower and the pure air exits from the bottom with the intention of minimizing the air pollution locally. See, it is very important. When a smog tower is installed at a particular place, it means the pollution reduces only in that vicinity. All right. And that is exactly why you should remember that these smog towers minimize the air pollution only locally. And there is also another type of smog tower in which the polluted air is collected from the bottom and the clean air is released from the top. For example, the smog tower installed in China, that works on this particular principle. And apart from that, the tower located behind the Shivaji Stadium in CP also works on similar principle. And this is all about the working of the smog towers. Now, coming to the points mentioned in the article. As we already saw recently, 2 new smog towers have been inaugurated in Delhi. And apart from this, Mumbai's clean air plan estimates that installing air filtration systems at major intersections will cost up to 25 crore. So even Mumbai has plans of installing these kind of air filters. While these initiatives show that the governments are concerned about air pollution and all, the deployment is often driven by symbolism and it is not backed by science. So what the author says is, the smog towers are only symbolic, but they really do not have a scientific backing that proves that the smog towers are valuable assets in reducing the air pollution. Okay, for example, the Delhi government claims that the newly installed smog tower in CP could reduce the air pollution levels by 80%. But there is no scientific evidence of smog towers or any other outdoor air filtration system, for that matter, improving the air qualities in cities. Even the smog towers installed in China, for that matter, did not prove to be effective at all. So smog towers, according to the author, provides an illusion of progress towards clean air, and it is also a waste of money. And that is what the author says. So basically, they mislead the policymakers and the public by diverting the attention away from the areas where actually there is a need for urgent attention. Therefore, the author suggests the government to postpone their plans to invest in these outdoor filtration systems, because 25 crores in Mumbai alone is not a joke, right? And data on the effectiveness of the newly installed smog towers should also be made publicly available for independent evaluation. And every additional tower built is a waste of taxpayers' money and residents' trust, because there is no scientific basis that backs the effectiveness of smog towers. So this is basically the essence. Besides, the author also gives some way forward also to combat the air pollution. Let's see that one by one. First, the author says air pollution monitoring should be expanded in places where there is little or no air quality monitoring. And additionally, forecasting capability should also be strengthened in these cities. How do you forecast air pollution? See, we know there is an issue of stubble burning in and around Delhi. And that causes pollution in Delhi during the months of October, November, December. So there is a spike in the air pollutions in Delhi. So based on these factors, the air pollution can be checked in Delhi. And apart from that, climate also contributes to the pollution. Say a dust storm also contributes to the pollution. So a forecast of the dust storm can actually help in reduction of the pollution. Okay, now going on to the second part. Emission inventories at the city levels must be updated on a regular basis. So what is an emission inventory? See, there is a industry and we have a definite amount of vehicles. We also will have a projection on how much vehicles will be sold in the near future. So based on all these things, how much emissions will happen? So that estimate is what is called as emission inventories. So every city must have an emission inventory to combat the pollution. So until last year, approximately 75% of our city's clean air plants lacked critical data on emissions from various polluting sources. See, these data are necessary for identifying major sources of air pollution and developing successful clean air programs that are specific for the local environment. Now, next, targeted efforts must be made to improve air quality for urban slum dwellers who have no access to clean cooking energy. See, in an urban slum, okay, what happens is the houses are all closely packed and they experience pollution from the industrial emissions, vehicular emissions. And apart from that, the urban slum dwellers sometimes do not have access even to the LPG, that is clean cooking fuel options. So what they do, they burn the woods and they cook. So there is a high chance of indoor pollution. So for an urban slum dweller, the exposure to the air pollution is twice compared to a normal urban dweller. So there should be efforts to target these set of people also. So what should be done? The policymakers must focus on providing LPG connections to these households along with ensuring sustained usage of LPG as a primary fuel. And most importantly, cities should strengthen their enforcement capacity by investing in people's and system that can keep a round-the-clock watch on both egregious and episodic polluters. So what does this fancy sentence mean? Basically, it means that the cities should make the people aware. That is, people themselves should be aware. Themselves, they should be vigilant to the pollutions that they themselves make and what the neighbors make or what the bystander makes. Okay, so self-behavior regulation is the key to bring down the pollutions in the air. So, in essence, the author says that India is experiencing an increase in the demand for clean air, but this cannot be met by unproven technological fixes like smog towers. Instead, we must vigorously pursue solutions that are rooted in science, as well as taking into account the social factors that causes the pollution. So, this is all about this particular article. See, in this article, we saw what is a smog tower. We saw about two types of smog towers. We saw about their workings as well. And apart from that, we also saw about the non-scientific basis in which these smog towers have been making their own space in the cities. And also, we saw the way forward. So, this is all about this particular article. With that, let's move on to the next segment of today's discussion. Now, look at this news article. This news article talks about a instrument called Nageshwaram or Nadaswaram, and sometimes it is even called as Nayanam. Okay. See, one notable feature of this particular instrument that you'll have to remember is it is a wind instrument. That is, the instrument is played by manipulating the wind through the instrument. See, as you can see from the picture, it is a conical double reed wind instrument, and it can be as long as about 95 centimeters, that is about 37 inches. And as you can see, most of the instruments are made up of dark wood, and it has a conical bore, and it has a flaring wooden bell at the bottom. And another thing that you should remember is there are about 7 equidistant finger holes on the front side. That is a side that faces outside. And these holes are manipulated by the hands to produce the music. And apart from that, there are also holes on the other side. And these holes are filled with waxes. And why is it filled? So that one can adjust these areas to adjust the tuning. And apart from that, extra reeds and the ivory needles for readjustment also are present in the instrument. They generally hang from the instrument. See, when I say reeds, look at the picture. Here is the reed through which the musician usually blows the wind inside the instrument. See, these reeds are made from the reeds found in the banks of river Kaveri in South India. So, as you can see, they are made from the ingredients in the South India. So, they are South Indian music instrument. That is, they are an important part of Carnatic music instrument. See, generally, they are played with another percussion instrument, and they find an important place in the South Indian rituals, be it marriage or be it temple functions. Nagaswaram plays an important role in these cultural events. And one thing that you will have to remember here is about the circular breathing. So, what is circular breathing? First, the air is drawn in through the nose and it is expelled from the cheeks into the reed of the instrument. So, basically, the air is drawn from the nose, goes to the mouth, into the cheeks, and it is expelled. And this is what is called as circular breathing. And this is used in the playing of this particular instrument. See, if you have to equate it to a North Indian instrument, it is Shehnai of North India. Generally, it is used in the Hindustani music. So, in equivalent of that in the Hindustani music is Shehnai, right? So, remember that. Keep this picture in mind so that you will be able to attempt any question based on this picture itself. Okay? So, this is a brief discussion on this particular wind instrument. With that, let's move on to the next segment of today's discussion. See, look at this article. This article has been already discussed very recently, say in August 28th discussion. So, we are not going to get into the details of this particular article. This article is about Mekadatu project. So, I request the aspirants to go back to August 28th and refer to the lecture then. And now we are at the fag end of today's discussion in the practice preliminary question discussion. So, in that effect, we have two questions for discussion today. Let's go over it one by one. So, the first question is a three-statement question, and this is in reference to the article we discussed today with respect to the Nobel Prize. So, let's go over it. In the context of neural control and coordination, which of the following statement is correct with reference to receptors? See, receptors are proteins crucial to body's communication process. See, when we were discussing even about the tongue, or for that matter pressure receptors, we saw every receptor has a unique reception capability, which in turn transmits it to the neural cells. So yes, receptors are a part of the communication process, and know that receptors are a protein also. Okay, so most of our body is made up of protein and receptors are no exception. So statement one is correct. It's a direct pick from NCERT. Statement two, gustatory receptors detect smell. See, gustatory in itself means taste, whereas olfactory means smell. So with that, statement two is incorrect. And coming to statement three. Statement 3 says the 2021 Nobel Prize in Medicine was awarded for the discoveries of receptors for temperature and touch. We just saw that. So that is the basic essence of that particular article. So statement 3 is correct. So the correct option is option D, 1 and 3. Moving on to the next question. This is in reference to the Forest Conservation Act that we discussed in the beginning of the discussion. So the question goes like this. The clearing of forest land for so-and-so activities are considered as non-forest purposes. We saw some list of NFPs. So the first one is the cultivation of horticultural crops or medicinal plants, reforestation, construction of dams. See, the correct option is option A. Because like we saw, any plantation crops or horticultural crops are non-forest purposes. And we saw reforestation is a forest purpose. Yes, we plant trees to grow forest, right? And we also saw this one particular peculiar exception as construction of dams as a forest purpose. So with that, we can say the right option is option A, cultivation of horticultural crops or medicinal plants. So with that, let's wind up our practice preliminary question session. So this is a mains question inspired from our discussion today. Write the answers and post it in the comment section for peer review. And with that, let's wrap up our discussion for today. Get vaccinated, wear a mask, stay safe. Good day.